ご覧のスポンサーの提供でお送りいたします。
Hello, Jackie.
Hi, pal.
Ladies and gentlemen, Julie Andrews and Jackie Gleason. How sweet it is.
First taste of showbiz was in musical.
Mine was the old Halsey Theater in Brooklyn. It's gone now, but they used to have an amateur night every Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And the winner got a gold watch.
Well, I'll bet you won.
Almost. I came in second. The winner was a performing mule.
You're joking?
I wish I was.
Huh. I wonder what the mule did with the watch.
I was supposed to do 5 minutes. I did 20. They had to take me off with a hook.
Well, nothing nearly as traumatic as that ever happened to me. Actually, when I first began, I literally had to be thrown onto the stage.
Take it from me, Jolie. It's a lot better than being thrown off the stage.
I think it would have come as quite a welcome relief to me. I was only 12 years old, you see, and to me, stepping in front of an audience was tantamount to stepping into the mouth of some fire-breathing dragon. You know what I mean?
I did until you used that word tantamount. It's a good thing you didn't start in burlesque. That's where I got my professional baptism. Walking out on that stage was...Well, it was tantamount to the solitary confinement.
Oh, the old silent treatment, huh?
Worse. There's practically no audience, just a handful of characters, patrons of the exotic art of dancing. And they came in every afternoon to gape at the girls and heckle me.
Well, I can't imagine anything worse than that.
I can, my act. With that material, I'm surprised they didn't come up and get me. There was a six-piece orchestra in the pit. They were tone deaf. And they'd play me on with some hokey music, and I'd come running out in a suit about nine times too large for me.
Wow. Please try and hold the applause down. I got a headache. Well, the gentleman in the third row, kindly put your hat on. The glare from your bald head is blinding me. Oh, ah.
You stink!
Any more remarks like that, and I'll report you to the manager.
I am the manager.
I'll have you know I turned down a wicked palace to play here.
You still stink!
Who are you?
The manager of the palace!
We're all on friendly terms. I have a couple of announcements to make.
Bring on the girls.
Before the show starts, if somebody who lost a wallet with a $10 bill in it will go to the back of the theater and form a single file, it'll be returned. It'll be returned to him.
You stink.
Who are you?
Your father.
Ha ha! The joke's on you. I don't have a father. Oh. And now, rolling right along, I'd like to introduce the star of our show. Direct from a convent in southern France, I'd like to introduce the electrifying, dynamic, exciting bundle of charm. Direct from Paris, France, Mademoiselle Bigby.
Oh.
telegram from Mr. Flo Ziegfeld. He was in here last night.
I'll bet he wants to sign us for the Follies.
Most likely he'll want to sign me.
Oh, no, I'm sure.
Here it is. The great Flo Ziegfeld, the star of our show, has just died, and he wants me to replace him.
In the show?
No, in the cemetery.
Did he play? The greatest.
Oh, thank you.
Not you. No, I was just thinking about that phrase, you're the greatest.
Oh, Ralph Cramden's famous last words.
Yeah, you may be kidding, but for a lot of married couples, those three little words may have replaced I love you in their vocabulary. They were very sincere and very succinct.
Succinct? First tantamount, now succinct. How'd you like to go to the moon?
Hey, you wouldn't have gotten away with that shabby treatment if I'd been on the show.
You?
Mm-hmm.
I had trouble understanding Allison Norton.
Oh, you still shoot a great stick.
Would you like to take a shot?
Oh, gosh, no. I've never played a game in my life.
You're not trying to hustle me, are you?
No.
Excuse me.
Oh, sorry. How long have you been playing?
Oh, ever since I was a kid. I used to hang out in pool rooms. Of course, in those days, they called them billiard academies. Pardon me? They taught a young boy how to lead a responsible life in the community. Taught him how to drink beer, how to smoke, how to take his friends to the cleaners.
Here you tell it, it sounds like a course in adult education.
I highly recommend it.
Oh, really?
Of course, there are some people who might disagree.
One or two at least.
Watch this.
Your troubled friends with a wave of my hand this very hand.
Please observe him, if you will. He's Professor Harold Hill, and I'm his assistant.
And we're here to organize River City Boys Band.
Boys Band!
Yes, you got trouble, my friends. Right here, I say trouble right here in River City. Why, sure, I'm a billiard player. Certainly mighty proud to say it. I consider that the hours I spend with a cue in my hand are golden.
Help you cultivate horse sense and a cool head and a keen eye. Do you ever take and try to give an ironclad leave to yourself from a three-rail billiard shop?
But just as they say it takes judgment, brains, and maturity to score in a ball-playing game, I say that any boo can take and shove a ball in a pocket.
And we call that sloth, the first big step on the road to the depths of degrade. I say first it's a little medicinal wine from a teaspoon,
then beer from a bottle.
And the next thing you know, you boys is playing for money in a fleece-back suit. And listen to some big out-of-town Jasper hearing him tell about horse race gambling.
Not a wholesome trotting race, no, but a race where they sit right down on the horse.
Like to see some stuck-up jockey boys sitting on Dan Patch. Make your blood boil.
Well, I should say.
Now, friends, let me tell you what we mean. You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pockets in the table. Pockets that mark the difference between a gentleman and a bum. Where the capital B and the crimes with P and N stands for pool. Have the right kind of parents. I'm gonna be perfectly frank. Would they like to know what kind of conversation goes on while you're loping around the hall?
You'll be trying out people.
Trying out cubits.
Trying out tailor-mades like cigarette peels.
And bragging all about how you're gonna cover up a telltale breath with sense-in.
One fine night, they leave the pool hall, headed for the dance at the armory. Libertine men and scarlet women and ragtime.
Oh, shameless music.
They'll drag your son and your daughter to the arms of a jungle animal instinct. Mysterious.
Friends, the idle brain is the devil's playground.
Trouble! Oh, we got trouble right here in River City. City. Right here in River City. With a capital T and that rhymes with P and that stands for fool.
That stands for fool.
We surely got trouble.
We surely got trouble.
Right here in River City.
Right here.
Gotta figure out a way to keep the young ones moral after school.
Our children's children gonna have trouble.
Mothers of River City, heed the warning before it's too late. Watch for the telltale signs of corruption. The minute your son leaves the house, does he rebuckle his knickerbockers below the knee?
Is there a nicotine stain on his index finger? A dime novel hidden in the corn crib? Is he starting to memorize jokes from Captain Billy's whiz bang?
Are certain words creeping into his conversation? Words like swell.
And so's your own man.
If so, my friend.
If so, my friend. You got trouble.
Oh, we got trouble.
Right here in River City.
Right here in River City.
With the capital T and that rhymes with P and that stands for fool.
That stands for fool.
We surely got trouble.
We surely got trouble.
Right here in River City.
Right here.
Remember the Maine, Plymouth Rock and the Golden Rule.
Our children's children gonna have trouble.
Oh, we got trouble.
Trouble.
We're in terrible, terrible trouble. That game with a 15 number all to the devil's tool.
He's a guy that's in trouble that everybody can laugh at.
I guess we're relieved it's happening to him and not to us, huh?
Well, that's what the poor soul's all about. He typifies the underdog. All the luckless little guys in the world that never really get a break. You see him every day. He's the guy that slips on a banana peel, or the guy that gets splashed by a passing car, or a flower pot falls on his head.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that life ever does a man. Somehow or another, he survives. But it just seems that life seems to get in his way.
Thank you. London ready?
I'd love it. There's a pub on every corner.
Oh, what about the rest of the city?
I wouldn't know. I've only seen the corners.
Well, dear.
That's good booze.
Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
The Japanese don't care to.
The Chinese wouldn't dare to. Hindus and Argentines sleep firmly from 12 to 1. But Englishmen detest the siesta.
In the Philippines there are lovely screens to protect you from the glare.
In the Malay states there are hats like plates which Britishers won't wear.
At 12 noon the natives swoon and know for the work is done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
Tell me, old boy, since you've been in London, have you been able to figure out the difference between dollars and cents and pounds and pence?
Oh, I figured it out the first day.
Oh, goody.
Yes, I lost 5 pounds and my pence fell down.
Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
The toughest Burmese bandit can never understand it.
In Hong Kong they strike a gong and fire a lonely gun
to reprimand each inmate who's in late.
In the mangrove swamps where the python romps, there is peace from 12 to 2.
Even caribous lie around in stews, for there's nothing else to do.
Tell me, Reggie, have you visited the tomb of Henry VIII?
Who was that young boy?
Oh, he was the infamous King of England. He had 6 wives, and he ate excessively, and he drank excessively, and he chased women excessively.
What makes you so sure he's dead? Maybe he's just resting now.
What you have?
Same thing? Coming up. Oh, it keeps the foam from boisting over the glass. Huh? Ah, we haven't had the pipes fixed. You know, everybody's going nuts, Mr. Dennehy. I call up the plumber today. I said, look, pal, I got a lot of rust in my pipes. It's making the beer look funny. He says, you got no problem. Just tell him you're serving dark beer.
Is he beautiful?
By the way, you notice how quiet it is in here since I put up that no ladies allowed sign?
No! So it's men only, is it? Well, just you ruddy well wait and see. You're not going to keep me out of here. Here. Who the hell do you think you are trying to keep me out of here? I know my rights. The law says a woman can have a drink in any old dump she wants, and this here's the old dump I want to have me drink in.
Look, Liza, this wasn't my idea. They took a vote. It was 18 against you and 1 for you.
Oh, really? And who was the one what voted for me?
Doesn't make any difference. He's not allowed in here.
Blokes ought to be grateful I come in here. If it wasn't for me, you wouldn't have no class in this joint at all.
Class? Just because you talk like Cary Grant don't mean you got class.
Chum, what about him over there? I suppose he's one of your posh eyebrow types.
Oh.
That bloke on top of the jukebox, the one that's trying to feed peanuts to the stuffed moose.
Oh, that's McNulty. He's a zookeeper. He's one of my best customers. As a matter of fact, this is the only joint he'll go to.
I bet the head waiter at the Ritz is absolutely green with envy.
Why is it that every woman comes in here gives me a headache? Some dame comes in the other night, she's wearing a black dress, a big open umbrella, and she tells me she can fly. Her name was Pippins, Peepins, Pappins.
Pippins? Mary Poppins?
Well, I figures you'd know her.
Oh, I know her all right. Oh, she fancies herself all prim and proper, she does. Just because she's got I am a lady printed all across her bloomers.
She has? She flew over so fast the other night, I didn't see that.
You know what? I don't think you want me hanging about here because you're afraid.
Afraid?
Yeah. You're afraid that if you saw me in here every night, you'd sort of take a shine to me. You know, you'd be whispering sweet nothings in my ear after a while. You'd be taking me for strolls in the park. And finally, I think you'd get down on your chubby little knees and propose to me. Well, don't you worry, Joe, me darling. I promised me mum I'd never marry beneath me station.
Now you're off your chump. Look, take your dandelions and get out of here.
There's nothing or no one can make me leave. I'm staying here tonight and every night from now on.
No, oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
That did it. Okay, Liza, you can take over the whole joint. You can take over everything that goes with it. The rusty pipes, the freeloaders, the guys falling asleep in the bar, and dames that come in here and drive me nuts.
And stay out. From now on, it's no men allowed.
Is my duty.
My lips will sing something jubilant, sweet and clear and strong, if you will take me along with you.
Done for, I guess.
Together we'll show them how that Charleston is done. We'll surprise everyone. Just think what heaven it's gonna be if you will Charleston, Charleston with me. Together we'll show them how the Charleston is done. We'll surprise everyone. Just think what heaven it's gonna be. My lips will sing something jubilant.
We'll be in touch with your agent.
I remember when I first started, I must have heard that line a million times. And I knew they were lying because I didn't have an agent.
I guess everybody dreads auditions.
It's all right when you're a kid. You heal fast. It's those guys that have been around for a while. They still have to get up there and audition every time they're looking for a role. They're the ones I feel for.
Yeah, well, you're not alone.
Just to have to hear those words again and again. Don't call us.
We'll call you.
Next.
Next.
This is the last one. Yeah, John Dennis. The John Dennis. I know, but his agent asked us to look at him anyway. It'll only take a moment. Okay. Mr. Dennis?
Well, that's a cue if I've ever heard one.
Mr. Dennis, this is our producer.
Oh, how do you do? It's a pleasure and a privilege. I don't have to tell you that your name in the theater is a hallmark of excellence.
Are you ready to read, Mr. Dennis?
You know, just the chance to audition for you is a credit in itself for an actor.
Did your agent tell you about the part?
Yeah, speaking of credits, I played this very same theater in 1943. It was a production of Nightfall. I co-starred with Paul Muni. The show's producer was the great Sam Harris. He gave me my first break. I shared top billing with Muni, above the title.
Would you like to turn to page...
Then in 1953, I played 268 performances as Buddy in The Dark Hours. That was at the old Mark Hellinger Theater. I remember on opening night, I came down with a touch of laryngitis. And in those days, there were no microphones. You know, you really had to project to get your voice across. Recently... Well, one thing and another, summer stock, dinner theaters, a couple of industrial shows. Broadway? Well, you know how it is. I've been waiting for something worthwhile to come along. Something for, you know, an actor of my caliber. I just don't know where all the playwrights are. You know, the Kaufmans, O'Neills.
Should we take it from your entrance, Mr. Dennis? Here.
Oh, yes. I guess we better. You know how we act us out once we get talking.
Yes. Now,
what is my motivation in this?
Well, why don't I just read the stage directions?
Thank you.
Enter Mossy. That's you, carrying a large carton of groceries. He is the neighborhood grocer and friend of the Davis family. I'll read Mrs. Davis' side of the dialogue. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay. Now, Marcy, when are you going to learn to knock before you enter? You're a friend of the family, not my husband.
What's the matter? Haven't I seen you in your robe and pajamas for the past 20 years?
Oh, don't remind me. Just put the groceries down.
How's Richie?
How should he be, getting his head knocked in every night at that gymnasium?
Well, don't worry about Richie, Mrs. Davies. He's going to be a fine boxer one day. He's got a natural gift.
You're not his mother.
If you want something to worry about the guy that climbs into the ring with Richie.
I don't want to hear about it, Mossy. It's the encouragement of sportsmen like you and his father that got him into prize fighting. A fine sport, beating strange boys senseless. Have a cup of coffee, Mossy.
No, thanks. I gotta get back to the store. And by the way, Mrs. Davis, tell Charlie the whole neighborhood is rooting for him.
Would you like to hear it again, sir?
Don't worry about Richie.
Oh, thank you very, very much, Mr. Dennis.
Well, shall we read the next scene?
Oh, there isn't any next scene.
You mean that's it?
Didn't your agent tell you about the part?
Well, he said it wasn't the lead, but I thought it would be at least a principal role.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Don't get me wrong. You know what they say. There are no small parts, just small actors. Sometimes a minor role in a great performance can catch the critic's eye. I'll take it.
We do have some other people to see.
Oh, of course.
Yes, we'll be in touch with your agent. Thank you so much, Mr. Dennis.
Anytime.
Thank you. Goodbye. Oh, Mr. Dennis, you forgot your hat.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Excuse me. I don't want to take up any more of your valuable time. I know you're a busy man. But may I tell you that I envy you? I could never do what you have to do. You know, sit there and make judgments of people. Must take a special knack, special gift, special indifference. Don't get me wrong. I'm sure it didn't come easy. That cold objectivity. Must have been a time when you first started, when you still had some compassion for everyone who came in for a job. Well, it still hurt you to give them the brush off. All right. I guess if you do it often enough, you get used to anything. That's what I envy. The difference between your end of the business and our profession. We never get used to this. Some profession. 35 years of sweat and grind, and you're still treated like a beginner. Like a 55-year-old office boy looking for a job with a chance for advancement. All those years. And what have I got to show for it? A couple of suits. I couldn't even get this one pressed. Well, Emperor, is it thumbs up or thumbs down? Do we get to work another day? Do we get to eat another day? Do we get to live another day?
Mr. Dennis, please don't do this to yourself. It's no way for an actor to behave.
Oh, yes, it is. I was doing what actors do best, showing off a little bit. That was a speech from scene 2, act 3 of The Company Man. It was written by Robert Morton. That's what you call acting. Tell the Emperor. Next!
Radio, the telephone, baby and say yes, or else I'm done for, I guess.
To dance with you is thrilling to my poor ego.
So baby, say you're willing to shake a leg. Oh, won't you Charleston with me? Won't you Charleston with me?
And while the band is playing that ovo-yodo, around we will go. Together we'll show them how that Charleston is done. We'll surprise everyone.
Just think what heaven it's gonna be if you will Charleston, Charleston with me.
Together we'll show them how the Charleston is done.
We'll surprise everyone.
Just think what heaven it's gonna be. My lips will sing something jubilant.
It's all right when you're a kid, you heal fast. It's those guys that been around for a while. They still have to get up there and audition every time they're looking for a role. They're the ones I feel for.
Yeah, well, you're not alone.
Just to have to hear those words again and again. Don't call us.
We'll call you.
Next.
Next.
This is the last one. Yeah, John Dennis. The John Dennis. I know, but his agent asked us to look at him anyway. It'll only take a moment. Okay. Mr. Dennis?
Well, that's a cue if I've ever heard one.
Mr. Dennis, this is our producer.
Oh, how do you do? It's a pleasure and a privilege. I don't have to tell you that your name in the theater is a hallmark of excellence.
Are you ready to read, Mr. Dennis?
You know, just the chance to audition for you is a credit in itself for an actor.
Did your agent tell you about the part?
Yeah, speaking of credits, I played this very same theater in 1943. It was a production of Nightfall. I co-starred with Paul Muni. The show's producer was the great Sam Harris. He gave me my first break. I shared top billing with Muni, above the title.
Would you like to turn to page...
Then in 1953, I played 268 performances as Buddy in The Dark Hours. That was at the old Mark Hellinger Theater. I remember on opening night, I came down with a touch of laryngitis. And in those days, there were no microphones. You know, you really had to project to get your voice across. Recently? Well, one thing and another. Summer stock, dinner theaters, a couple of industrial shows. Broadway? Well, you know how it is. I've been waiting for something worthwhile to come along. Something for, you know, an actor of my caliber. I just don't know where all the playwrights are. You know, the Kaufmans, O'Neills.
Should we take it from your entrance, Mr. Dennis? Here.
Oh, yes, I guess we better. You know how we actors are once we get talking.
Yes. Now,
what is my motivation in this?
Well, why don't I just read the stage directions?
Thank you.
Enter Mossy, that's you. Carrying a large carton of groceries. He is the neighborhood grocer and friend of the Davis family. I'll read Mrs. Davis' side of the dialogue. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay. Now, Marcy, when are you going to learn to knock before you enter? You're a friend of the family, not my husband.
What's the matter? Haven't I seen you in your robe and pajamas for the past 20 years?
Oh, don't remind me. Just put the groceries down.
How's Richie?
How should he be, getting his head knocked in every night at that gymnasium?
Well, don't worry about Richie, Mrs. Davies. He's going to be a fine boxer one day. He's got a...
ご覧のスポンサーの提供でお送りいたします。
Jackie.
Hiya, pal.
Ladies and gentlemen, Julie Andrews and Jackie Gleason. How sweet it is.
First taste of showbiz was in musical.
Mine was the old Halsey Theater in Brooklyn. It's gone now, but they used to have an amateur night every Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And the winner got a gold watch.
Well, I'll bet you won.
Almost. I came in second. The winner was a performing mule.
You're joking?
I wish I was.
Huh. I wonder what the mule did with the watch.
I was supposed to do 5 minutes. I did 20. They had to take me off with a hook.
Well, nothing nearly as traumatic as that ever happened to me. Actually, when I first began, I literally had to be thrown onto the stage.
Take it from me, Jolie. It's a lot better than being thrown off the stage.
I think it would have come as quite a welcome relief to me. I was only 12 years old, you see, and to me, stepping in front of an audience was tantamount to stepping into the mouth of some fire-breathing dragon. You know what I mean?
I did until you used that word tantamount. It's a good thing you didn't start in burlesque. That's where I got my professional baptism. Walking out on that stage was... well, it was tantamount to the solitary confinement.
Oh, the old silent treatment, huh?
Worse. There's practically no audience, just a handful of characters, patrons of the exotic art of dancing. And they came in every afternoon to gape at the girls and heckle me.
Well, I can't imagine anything worse than that.
I can, my act. With that material, I'm surprised they didn't come up and get me. There was a six-piece orchestra in the pit.
Oh.
They were tone deaf. And they'd play me on with some hokey music, and I'd come running out in a suit about nothing. Huh? Ah, we haven't had the pipes fixed. You know, everybody's going nuts, Mr. Donahue. I call up the plumber today. I said, look, pal, I got a lot of rust in my pipes. It's making the beer look funny. He says, you got no problem. Just tell him you're serving dark beer.
She's beautiful.
By the way, you notice how quiet it is in here since I put up that no ladies allowed sign?
No! So it's men only, is it? Well, just you ruddy well wait and see. You're not going to keep me out of here. Yeah. Who the hell do you think you are trying to keep me out of here? I know my rights. The law says a woman can have a drink in any old dump she wants, and this here's the old dump I want to have me drink in.
Look, Liza, this wasn't my idea. They took a vote. It was 18 against you and one for you.
Oh, really? And who was the one what voted for me?
Doesn't make any difference. He's not allowed in here.
Blokes ought to be grateful I come in here. If it wasn't for me, you wouldn't have no class in this joint at all.
Class? Just because you talk like Cary Grant don't mean you got class.
Chum, what about him over there? I suppose he's one of your posh eyebrow types.
Oh.
Bloke on top of the jukebox, the one that's trying to feed peanuts to the stuffed moose.
Oh, that's McNulty. He's a zookeeper. He's one of my best customers. As a matter of fact, this is the only joint he'll go to.
I'll bet the head waiter at the Ritz is absolutely green with envy.
Why is it that every woman comes in here gives me a headache?
Some dame comes in the other night, she's wearing a black dress, a big open umbrella, and she tells me she can fly. Her name was Pippins, Peepins.
Poppins? Mary Poppins?
Well, I figures you'd know
her. Oh, I know her all right. Oh, she fancies herself all prim and proper, she does. Just because she's got I am a lady printed all across her bloomers.
Yes? She flew over so fast the other night, I didn't see that.
You know what? I don't think you want me hanging about here because you're afraid.
Afraid?
Yeah. You're afraid that if you saw me in here every night, you'd sort of take a shine to me. You know, you'd be whispering sweet nothings in my ear after a while. You'd be taking me for strolls in the park. And finally, I think you'd get down on your chubby little knees and propose to me. Well, don't you worry, Joe, me darling. I promised me mum I'd never marry beneath me station.
Now you're off your chump. Look, take your dandelions and get out of here.
There's nothing or no one can make me leave. I'm staying here tonight and every night from now on.
No, oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
That did it. Okay, Liza, you can take over the whole joint. You can take over everything that goes with it. The rusty pipes, the free... telegram from Mr. Flo Ziegfeld. He was in here last night.
I'll bet he wants to sign us for the Follies.
Most likely he'll want to sign me.
Oh, no, I'm sure.
Here it is. The great Flo Ziegfeld, the star of our show, has just died, and he wants me to replace him.
In the show?
No, in the cemetery.
Did he play?
The greatest.
Oh, thank you.
Not you. No, I was just thinking about that phrase, you're the greatest.
Oh, Ralph Cramden's famous last words.
Yeah, you may be kidding, but for a lot of married couples, those three little words may have replaced I love you in their vocabulary. They were very sincere and very succinct.
Succinct. First tantamount, now succinct. How'd you like to go to the moon?
Hey, you wouldn't have gotten away with that shabby treatment if I'd been on the show.
You?
Mm-hmm.
I had trouble understanding Allison Norton.
Oh, you still shoot a great stick.
Would you like to take a shot?
Oh, gosh, no. I've never played a game in my life.
You're not trying to hustle me, are you?
No.
Excuse me.
Oh, sorry. How long have you been playing?
Oh, ever since I was a kid. I used to hang out in pool rooms. Of course, in those days, they called them billiard academies. Pardon me? They taught a young boy how to lead a responsible life in the community. Taught him how to drink beer, how to smoke, how to take his friends to the cleaners.
Here you tell it, it sounds like a course in adult education.
I highly recommend it.
Just think what heaven it's gonna be if you will Charleston, Charleston with me.
Together we'll show them how the Charleston is done.
surprise everyone. Just think what heaven it's gonna be. My lips will sing something jubilant, sweet and clear and strong. If you will take me along, take me along, take me along with you.
What about the old one? We'll be in touch with your agent.
I remember when I first started. I must have heard that line a million times. And I knew they were lying because I didn't have an agent.
I guess everybody dreads auditions.
That's all right when you're a kid. You heal fast. It's those guys that have been around for a while. They still have to get up there and audition every time they're looking for a role. They're the ones I feel for.
Yeah, well, you're not alone.
Just to have to hear those words again and again. Don't call us.
We'll call you.
Next.
Next.
This is the last one. Yeah, John Dennis. The John Dennis. I know, but his agent asked us to look at him anyway. It'll only take a moment. Okay. Mr. Dennis?
Well, that's a cue if I've ever heard one.
Mr. Dennis, this is our producer.
Oh, how do you do? It's a pleasure and a privilege. I don't have to tell you that your name in the theater is a hallmark of excellence.
Are you ready to read, Mr. Dennis?
You know, just the chance to audition for you is a credit in itself for an actor.
Did your agent tell you about the part?
Yeah, speaking of credits, I played this very same theater in 1943. It was a production of Nightfall. I co-starred with Paul Munich and my pipes.
It's making the beer look funny. He says, you got no problem. Just tell him you're serving dark beer.
Is he beautiful?
By the way, you notice how quiet it is in here since I put up that no ladies allowed sign?
No! So it's men only, is it? Well, just you ruddy well wait and see. You're not going to keep me out of here. Here. Who the hell do you think you are trying to keep me out of here? I know my rights. The law says a woman can have a drink in any old dump she wants, and this here's the old dump I want to have me drink in.
Look, Liza, this wasn't my idea. They took a vote. It was 18 against you and one for you.
Oh, really? And who was the one what voted for me?
Doesn't make any difference. He's not allowed in here.
Blokes ought to be grateful I come in here. If it wasn't for me, you wouldn't have no class in this joint at all.
Class? Just because you talk like Cary Grant don't mean you got class.
You chump. What about him over there? I suppose he's one of your posh eyebrow types.
Oh.
That bloke on top of the jukebox, the one that's trying to feed peanuts to the stuffed moose.
Oh, that's McNulty. He's a zookeeper. He's one of my best customers. As a matter of fact, this is the only joint he'll go to.
I'll bet the head waiter at the Ritz is absolutely green with envy.
Why is it that every woman comes in here gives me a headache? Some dame comes in the other night, she's wearing a black dress, a big open umbrella, and she tells me she can fly. Her name was Peepins.
Mary Poppins?
Well, I figures you'd know her.
Oh, I know her, all right. Oh, she fancies herself all prim and proper, she does. Just because she's got I am a lady printed all across her bloomers.
She has? She flew over so fast the other night, I didn't see that.
You know what? I don't think you want me hanging about here because you're afraid.
Afraid?
Yeah. You're afraid that if you saw me in here every night, you'd sort of take a shine to me. You know, you'd be whispering sweet nothings in my ear after a while. You'd be taking me for strolls in the park. And finally, I think you'd get down on your chubby little knees and propose to me. Well, don't you worry, Joe, me darling. I promised me mum I'd never marry beneath me station.
Now you're off your chump. Look, take your dandelions and get out of here.
There's nothing or no one can make me leave. I'm staying here tonight and every night from now on.
No, oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
That better. Okay, Liza, you can take over the whole joint. You can take over everything that goes with it. The rusty pipes, the freeloaders, the guys falling asleep in the bar, and things that come in here and drive me nuts.
That bloke on top of the jukebox, the one that's trying to feed peanuts to the stuffed moose.
Oh, that's McNulty. He's a zookeeper. He's one of my best customers. As a matter of fact, this is the only joint he'll go to.
I'll bet the head waiter at the Ritz is absolutely green with envy.
Why is it that every woman comes in here gives me a headache? Some dame comes in the other night, she's wearing a black dress, a big open umbrella, and she tells me she can fly. Her name was Pippins, Peepins.
Poppins? Mary Poppins?
Well, I figures you'd know her.
Oh, I know her all right. Oh, she fancies herself all prim and proper, she does. Just because she's got I am a lady printed all across her bloomers.
She has? She flew over so fast the other night, I didn't see that.
You know what? I don't think you want me hanging about here because you're afraid.
Afraid?
Yeah. You're afraid that if you saw me in here every night, you'd sort of take a shine to me. You know, you'd be whispering sweet nothings in my ear after a while. You'd be taking me for strolls in the park. And finally, I think you'd get down on your chubby little knees and propose to me. Well, don't you worry, Joe, me darling. I promised me mum I'd never marry beneath me station.
Now you're off your chump. Look, take your dandelions and get out of here.
There's nothing or no one can make me leave. I'm staying here tonight and every night from now on.
No, oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
That better. Okay, Liza, you can take over the whole joint. You can take over everything that goes with it. The rusty pipes, the freeloaders, the guys falling asleep in the bar, and things that come in here and drive me nuts.
Started. I must have heard that line a million times, and I knew they were lying because I didn't have an agent.
I guess everybody dreads auditions.
It's all right when you're a kid. You heal fast. It's those guys that have been around for a while. They still have to get up there and audition every time they're looking for a role. They're the ones I feel for.
Yeah, well, you're not alone.
Just to have to hear those words again and again. Don't call us.
We'll call you.
Next.
Next.
This is the last one. Yeah, John Dennis. The John Dennis. I know, but his agent asked us to look at him anyway. It'll only take a moment. Okay. Mr. Dennis?
Well, that's a cue if I've ever heard one.
Mr. Dennis, this is our producer.
Oh, how do you do? It's a pleasure and a privilege. I don't have to tell you that your name in the theater is a hallmark of excellence.
Are you ready to read, Mr. Dennis?
You know, just the chance to audition for you is a credit in itself for an actor.
Did your agent tell you about the part?
Yeah, speaking of credits, I played this very same theater in 1943. It was a production of Nightfall. I co-starred with Paul Muni. The show's producer was the great Sam Harris. He gave me my first break. I shared top billing with Muni, above the title.
Would you like to turn to page...
Then in 1953, I played 268 performances as Buddy in The Dark Hours. That was at the old Mark Hellinger Theater. I remember on opening night, I came down with a touch of laryngitis. And in those days, there were no microphones. You know, you really had to project to get your voice across. Recently? Well, one thing and another. Summer stock, dinner theaters, a couple of industrial shows. Broadway? Well, you know how it is. I've been waiting for something worthwhile to come along. Something for, you know, an actor of my caliber. I just don't know where all the playwrights are. You know, the Kaufmans, O'Neills.
Should we take it from your entrance, Mr. Dennis? Here.
Oh, yes, I guess we better. You know how we actors are once we get talking.
Yes. Now,
what is my motivation in this?
Well, why don't I just read the stage directions?
Thank you.